Okay, go ahead and have a seat, and as you do so, open up your Bibles to the book of Acts, and we are in chapter...
Six.
No, who said six? Chapter seven. Chapter seven. Okay, chapter seven. And of course, for those of you who may just be joining us, we are learning all about the church, the early church as it started. And some have rightly referred to the book of Acts as the Acts of the Holy Spirit. For back then is when the Holy Spirit birthed his church as we know it today. The followers of Jesus were commissioned to go out and proclaim the same gospel message that Jesus proclaimed, and he told them to go make disciples of all the nations, starting in their hometown of Jerusalem, but going out from there to Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. And we're just about in the story to the place where they do start to go out. But before we get there, there's this amazing chapter 7. Empowered by the Holy Spirit, we are going to see one of the greatest sermons ever preached. And so by now you should be there at chapter 7. But let me just give you a little bit of a setting of the scene here. Because you remember in the end of chapter 6, there was a man by the name of Stephen. You remember him? Stephen was one who was chosen from among the believers to be one of the deacons, or one of the kind of ministry servant leaders in the church. What had happened was there arose a complaint among a group of these new believers. They were known as the Hellenists. They were people who had been greatly influenced by Greek culture, but they were still Jews nonetheless, and they had become followers of Jesus in particular. But even in the midst of this great outpouring of the Holy Spirit, there was love among all the believers. There was sharing of their goods and their resources and their lives together. And it was all just an amazing thing. The world had never seen anything quite like this. But wherever you get a bunch of sinners together, you're going to eventually have problems. And such was the case then. They were facing trouble from without through persecution, but they also encountered some problems from within, just through the natural selfishness that us humans tend to default to, even in the best of circumstances. And so these people came to the apostles and they said, you know, we're feeling neglected. Our grandmas are being neglected at the time, you know, when we gather to eat, and the daily distribution of food and resources. And so the apostles dealt with this in a very practical way. They said, choose from among you seven men who are of good reputation and who are full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom. And so these guys had to be good, and they had to be godly, and they had to be filled with grace and wisdom. And they chose from among themselves these seven men. And one of them was Stephen. And the Bible says that he was also full of faith and power, and he did great signs and wonders. And whenever God's doing a great work through anyone, it's not just that people notice, but Satan notices. And there begins to be this attack, a spiritual battle that can take place in our lives when we get serious about following the Lord and serving Christ. And such was the case with this man, Stephen. He started to attract attention, just like the apostles had, from the Jewish leadership of that time, which was opposing what they called a sect, these Christians. And they were upset about the message they were preaching, and they certainly didn't appreciate that they were doing it right in and around the Temple Mount area. But the church was swelling by now into the thousands, the tens of thousands, and so the persecution started to ramp up. Now, what you have to remember from the story, because it segues into our story today, is that when they encountered Stephen and he was preaching this message and he was doing the signs and the wonders and the miracles that validated the message, just the way God had worked through the apostles and just the way God had worked through Jesus, they started to focus their attack and attention on him, just the way they had done with the apostles and with Jesus. And so it was just, you know, his turn, so to speak. And so he finds himself taken before the Jewish Supreme Court, what they called the Sanhedrin. And so he's there in the halls of justice, so-called. Although we're going to see in the story that what they did was anything but just. And so they were having sort of this mock trial, just like they had done with Christ. Remember when he was taken before Caiaphas and Pilate and the high priest, all these people? And it was just a travesty of justice. But that's kind of the scene here. And they had accused him of saying blasphemous things against their law and against their temple. And this was a big deal to these Jewish leaders. And so if you can imagine sort of a courtroom scene. Now, if you go into a courtroom, and if, particularly if you're going to be a witness in a case, what do they have you do? They have you swear. They you put your hand on the Bible and you swear, and you say these words. I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And that's all well and good, but how many of you know that sometimes people can't handle the truth? I think that was a line in a movie. You can't handle the truth. So anyway, I've entitled the message this morning, The Truthful Witness. The Truthful Witness. And this is just going to be part one. But what I want you to notice as we go along, we're going to learn some lessons from Stephen's life. First of all, he teaches us to be unashamed of the gospel. We are going to see at the end of this story that there is a man named Saul, who we come to know as the beloved Apostle Paul. But this is before, this is BC days for Paul. Okay, this is when he was among the Sanhedrin. He was among those people that were persecuting the early Christians, and he hated them, and he didn't want to hear their message. And here he listens to this powerful man of God named Stephen, who is unashamed of the gospel. And it will be our beloved Apostle Paul who one day would say, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. And I believe this was his first example that was used by God to lead him to Christ. Stephen's life also teaches us to trust the Lord in the face of persecution, to learn from history. As someone rightly said, the only thing we learn from history is that we don't learn from history. And he's going to give them a history lesson for sure. And Stephen's life teaches us not only how to live, but how to die in faith. It is one of the greatest sermons ever preached. I don't think I can do it justice, but I'm going to try. He also warns against dead religion. This is so important. We touch on this from time to time because it's just our default mode, our tendency to go back to religion, to tradition, to works, and these sorts of things, looking to them for our sense of security and identity and even salvation. And he warns against our tendency to put tradition over Christ himself. And his life also reminds us of the dangers of stubborn rebellion in the face of God's relentless and amazing grace. Oh, God has been so relentless in his pursuit of his people and so generous in his grace. And so we're going to pick it up in verse 1. The high priest said, are these things so? What things? Well, they had trumped up charges against Stephen, and they had falsely accused him of speaking against their law and against their temple. And so Caiaphas opens up by saying, is this true? Now, the thing you have to understand about Stephen, he was not a wimp. He was not concerned at all with being acquitted. He knew the character and the determination of his enemies. He knew what they were up to, that he was a marked man. This was his concern. He wanted to unravel the true from the false, and he wanted them to see the true nature of Christianity. And so he says, verse 2, brethren and fathers, listen. The God of glory appeared to our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he dwelt in Haran. And he said to him, get out of your country and from your relatives and come to a land that I will show you. And so point one, as we get started, is that God made certain promises to Abraham. Okay, and Stephen's going to unpack this a little bit for us, give us a little history lesson of the Jews. And he begins his defense with Abraham. Why? Because that's where the life of faith began for the Jews. Very important. Also, the revelation of God to Abram was completely independent of Moses, the law, and the temple. Also very important to note. God is not restricted to a special time or a special place. He can reveal himself whenever he wills, wherever he wills, and to whomever he wills. Something else to notice as he goes through the story is that there is movement. There's progress in God's dealings with his people. Abraham was going to become a pilgrim, a stranger on the earth. In other words, I take this to be a reminder that the believer's faith is not this sort of static thing. We don't sink roots here. Our home is in heaven, and we're journeying there. That's the goal. That's the destination. But they had become so rooted in their tradition and their rituals and then everything they added to God's word that they weren't able to really learn and grow and progress spiritually the way that God intended. We're not rooted in an institution, however great that institution might be. And what we're going to see is this is a very clever way to start the sermon. Stephen knew who he was dealing with. He begins with their national hero. He starts with God's revelation to Abraham. God revealed himself to Abraham in such a convincing way that he picked up and moved and agreed to go where God sent him. He just left his homeland to follow wherever God might lead. And Stephen's going to come back to this again in his defense. But the point I want you to note is that we need to always be willing to move when God says move. We need to be willing to go where God says to go, or we too are prone to get stuck in religious tradition, and we lose sight of that ongoing, growing relationship with Christ. Are you willing to do a new work in your life, or are you stuck in the past? Verse 4 says he came out of the land of the Chaldeans and dwelt in Haran, and from there, when his father was dead, he moved him to this land in which you now dwelt. And so Abraham left Ur and settled in Haran. This was a city in the upper Euphrates Valley, and you need to understand that settling in Haran was a compromise. Remember, God told him to go, and he took a little step of faith. Okay, that's enough. Whew, don't want to overdo it. and he settles there, and I suspect that it was probably under the influence of his father, Terah. How many of you, you don't have to raise your hands, but in your heart, raise your hand. If you've taken steps of faith, and you know, it's hard enough to come to the place where you really are surrendered to the Lord, and you finally do it. You finally start taking a step of faith, and then some family member just starts giving you a hard time. It's like, what are you doing? You don't need to do all that. You go to church on Wednesdays too? What's the matter with you? Get a life, you know. And so there's steps of faith that God will call us to take. And Abraham, I think, here is an example of partial obedience, delayed obedience. You know what I used to tell my kids when they were growing, and then we were little, and we were especially, I mean, we still talk about it today, but when they're really little, we would say delayed obedience is
disobedience.
And I think we see a picture of that here. Are you settling for compromise? That's the question. Are you sort of lagging behind God? We don't want to run ahead of God, but we also don't want to lag behind God. Well, God had no intention of allowing Abraham to settle anywhere in Mesopotamia. So he was uprooted once again and sent on his way to Canaan. So verse 5, God gave him no inheritance in it, not even enough to set his foot on. But even when Abraham had no child, he promised to give it to him for a possession and to his descendants after him. Now, what you need to understand at this point is Stephen is undermining, and he's going to do this over and over again, he's undermining the notion that the temple was ever intended by God to be a permanent institution. Abraham didn't have any kind of tangible possession in the land of Canaan. His faith was exercised along spiritual lines. He had a promise, but not a place. And the reason was because God wanted his faith to be in him alone. And what Stephen is very cleverly doing is he's underlining the spiritual roots of the Hebrew faith, and he's pointing to the spiritual nature of what we know as New Testament Christianity. God was doing a new work, and the Christian faith doesn't ultimately care about sacred shrines and holy places. And we need to be honest about that. I know that that's, you know, them's fighting words in many places among many people, because we get emotionally attached to holy shrines and holy places. And even among evangelical Christianity, we can do the same thing. Again, I won't ask for a show of hands, but maybe some of you are like, what happened to the Calvary dove? I'm like, you know, there's just stuff like that. Well, you know, and we just have to be careful, you know. It will return, by the way. I'm just going to do something a little different. Anyhow, well, we have to be careful. We have to be careful. Nothing wrong with buildings and traditions, per se, but we must realize that Jesus wants to dwell in our hearts, Lord of our lives, be the focus of our worship, not some building. Verse 6 says that God spoke in this way, that his descendants would dwell in a foreign land and that they would bring them into bondage and oppress them 400 years. So not only was Abraham not to have some kind of, you know, permanent stake in the promised land, but his descendants were actually going to leave the land and they would settle in Egypt, and they were going to be oppressed for 400 years, and God was going to have to intervene in judgment. This was part of the story that God was unfolding, and it was all going to happen long before the promise of the land to Abraham would be fulfilled by God. And so all of this would have been a tremendous test of Abraham's faith. But the point is, in the context of this sermon, it's a rebuke, okay? It's a rebuke to those who thought that biblical belief was tied to the temple. And at the very beginning of Jewish national life, and for four long centuries, the chosen people, get this, the chosen people weren't even in the promised land. Moses hadn't come yet. The law hadn't been given yet. There was no temple. They were a persecuted minority in Egypt. And Stephen's accusers would not have missed the point of this argument. Abraham's faith rested on what? The simple word of God. His faith rested in the wisdom and power of the one who had made the promise to him. Are you trusting in the promises of God's word? Are you trusting in the character of God? Or are you putting your hope in a system, a philosophy, a man-made system of rules and rites and rituals and regulations? Are you putting your hope in the outward trappings of religion? Verse 7, the nation to whom they will be in bondage, I will judge, said God, and after that they shall come out and serve me in this place. God is able to safeguard his own promises, and time and distance don't make any difference to God. It's a big deal to us. We get really hung up on time and distance, and we also get hung up when we face an enemy that seems overwhelming. And remember, in their context, there was this world superpower that was very anti-Semitic, the Pharaoh in Egypt. He had a very mighty army, but God was not impressed. God, in fact, was going to confront this Pharaoh. And he was going to do so in the form of 10 plagues. Do you remember the story of the plagues and the story of the Exodus in Egypt? And God comes at Pharaoh with 10 plagues. And each of these plagues is aimed at a specific demonic false god that they worshiped. It was a way of saying, I'm bigger than your God. The reason God did this was twofold. It was to deliver his people, and it was to declare his glory and show his glory, to glorify his name. And so, again, all of this was foreseen by God and foretold to Abraham. What enemy do you face today? I hope that this story reminds you that you can trust the Lord to deliver you and glorify his name. He's working for your deliverance and his glory. Verse 8 is interesting. It says, he gave them the covenant of circumcision. Now, culturally speaking, that's a little strange for us. You didn't have to be circumcised to come to Calvary Chapel. That'd be a little weird. But for them, that was a very real thing. And one commentator put it this way. He said, God took the cutting edge of the knife and brought it to bear on all that spoke of the reproductive energy of the flesh. And Abraham was taught symbolically to bear in his body the marks of the Lord Jesus. And the point is that no fleshly energy will bring God's promises to pass. It's very important to remember that. We see in the story of the patriarchs, sometimes they wanted to give God a hand. Remember Sarah and Hagar and that whole story? Remember Jacob and Rachel and the baby-making derby? It was like this whole weird thing that went on, and people trying to give God a hand. And yet God sovereignly just ordained all of this step by step in his good time. No fleshly energy would bring the promises of God to pass. And Abraham was to look beyond himself to God and to teach his children and his grandchildren the same. And so Abraham, the text says, begot Isaac and circumcised him on the eighth day. And Isaac begot Jacob, and Jacob begot the 12 patriarchs. So again, no temple, no law. The essential faith of the fathers was passed on from generation to generation by the word of God. Simple dependence on the word of God. And it went on like that for generations. It went on like that for centuries and would have continued to do so. The law isn't the problem. Paul said in Romans 7, is there something wrong with the law? The fact that I sinned, does it mean that there's something wrong with God's law? Because Paul said, the law said, don't covet, and then what do? I start coveting. Oh, you mean that. Okay, I guess that's what I want now. And that's the way sin is. God says, don't do, and our flesh says, I want to do. And there's this spiritual nature of ours that has been touched by the fall, and it's a sinful nature now. And so the law came in as just a very practical means of defining really what human behavior was supposed to be like. And certainly, all through the story, you see that it also provided illustrations of divine truth. But that's all it was intended to be. It's something that just basically declared to us what God is like in his holiness and what we're like in our sinfulness. And he said, this is the standard. And in the process of trying to reach that standard but falling short, we are to come to the conclusion, the humble conclusion, I can't do it. I can't keep this holy standard. God, you're going to have to do something. I need your grace and mercy in order to live the way you want me to live. And God's law, the Bible says, was like a tutor to lead us to Christ. The temple also was very practical. It was sort of a rallying point for the faith. Sort of like here, we gather in this building, and there's kind of a cool vibe here. You know, we come as fellow believers, and there's a lot of love and a lot of fellowship and a lot of joy, and it's just really neat to come together. But there's nothing special about, the beams and boards that hold this building together. This isn't a sacred building, per se. It's the people inside. It's the Holy Spirit working in and through our lives. I have a friend that I've been ministering to for a couple of decades now, and he comes sometimes, and then he goes away for a while, and he comes, and then he goes for a while. And sometimes he tells me he likes to come here and just kind of sit in the silence and just enjoy being here in the sanctuary, and that's fine. I'm glad that this is a peaceful place and a place he likes to come, but sometimes he will sit on the curb outside. He doesn't feel worthy to come in, and no matter how many times I tell him, your worthiness has nothing whatsoever to do with your performance. Jesus and his performance, he lived the life you couldn't live, and he died the death you deserved, and it was by grace and mercy, and you now can enter into fellowship with the Lord and enjoy the forgiveness of your sin, and you don't have to live under this burden of guilt and shame and condemnation anymore. And it's not the building that's so wonderful. It gets old. The carpet gets dirty. Paint gets old. It all just gets old, and it's not all that great. What is great is a relationship with the Lord Jesus and him dwelling inside you now as a temple, as it were, of the living God. But they didn't understand these things. The patriarchs had managed just fine without the temple. Even under the most difficult trials and tests of faith, Christianity was a return to simple faith in God himself. It could be done without rules and rituals because they had the reality, a relationship with Jesus Christ. What about you? Does this sort of sound a little bit sacrilegious? It does in some circles. It certainly did in those circles to the audience that Stephen was speaking to. It was just blasphemous. And they prided themselves on knowing the Word of God. But Stephen was helping them, trying to help them get to see the God of the Word and the whole point of it all. The second thing I want you to see is God's faithfulness through Joseph. We've touched on the promise of God to Abraham, but now God's faithfulness through Joseph. Verse 9 says, the patriarchs, becoming envious, sold Joseph into Egypt, but God was with him. I love that. You go back and read the story of Joseph in Genesis 37 through 50, and I think in chapter 39, four times it says in that chapter, there's this repeated phrase, that God was with Joseph, the Lord was with Joseph, and he was with Joseph. Just over and over again, we're reminded God was with Joseph, and that's one of the lessons of the story of Joseph. We learn that God was with him. There was a lot of bad stuff coming down in his life. If you just looked at the face of it, you know, it seemed terrible and unfair and all the rest. And God's forsaken Joseph. And the Bible wants you to know, God says, no, I didn't. I'm right there with him. Just like he's with you right now, going through whatever trials you may be facing and disappointments of life. And so Stephen now changes his angle of attack to show that the Jewish people, right from the very start, had resisted God's plans for them. Their unbelief began with their treatment of Joseph, one of the great types or pictures of Christ in the Old Testament. And just as the Sanhedrin had rejected Jesus, so too the patriarchs had rejected Joseph. And for the very same reason, envy. Do you remember Pilate? It says in, I think, Matthew 27, he knew very well that it was for envy that the Jewish leaders had delivered Jesus to him for judgment. So the Jews, you got to at least say this much, they were consistent throughout their history. The sons of Jacob united themselves to get rid of Joseph, and the leaders in Israel united themselves to get rid of Jesus. The patriarchs resented Joseph because of his goodness, and his goodness stood out in contrast to their wickedness. And that's how it was with Jesus. But Stephen didn't need to, make that obvious parallel. They understood. Verse 10, it says, continuing on the life of Joseph, that God delivered him out of all his troubles and gave him favor and wisdom in the presence of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he made him governor over Egypt and all his house. And so Joseph was was this amazing type or picture of Jesus in so many ways. If you've never studied the life of Joseph and the life of Jesus and considered the parallels between them, it's such a fun study, and I encourage you to do it. I mean, there are just dozens and dozens of examples that we see in the life of Joseph that directly parallel with Jesus. For example, Joseph was rejected by his brothers. He was sold for the price of a slave. He was handed over to Gentiles. He was falsely accused. He was made to suffer for sins that he did not commit. He was cast out by the Gentiles and put in the place of death. He took possession of the keys of the prison and ruled there as he ruled everywhere. And so it goes on through the life of Joseph. He could not be held down. It's amazing how he survived the attempts on his life and survived prison and was ultimately exalted to this place of majesty, really. He was second in command at the right hand of Pharaoh, the ruler of the known world. And this is what's so fun. Get this. If you go back to the story of Joseph, and he's raised up to this place of prominence in the story. Pharaoh gives him this interesting name. It's a long name. You don't want to try to say it five times fast, okay? It's a tongue twister. It's Zaphnath-Paaneah. Zaphnath-Paaneah. Do you know what it means? It means the savior of the world. And, you know, those of you who know the story, you immediately understand why there was a famine in the land, and that Pharaoh delegated to Joseph this task of just doling out the resources and taking care of the people, making sure Egypt was going to weather the storm, you know. And he had this name. Genesis 41:45 tells us so. And you know in the story that Joseph's brothers eventually came to him, and a dream that he'd had some 22 or 25 years prior was that his brothers would bow down to him. All of this is a type. All of this is a picture. All of this is pointing to our Savior Christ. Do you remember what Paul would say later in the book of Philippians in chapter 2? He said of Jesus that he would be given a name above every other name. And do you know the Hebrew name for Jesus is Yeshua, and it means Jehovah is salvation, Savior of the world. And at that name, every knee would what? Bow, and every tongue would confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. Isn't that interesting? Stephen didn't need to tell him the whole story. He didn't need to make all of the obvious applications of that story to Christ. They could see where he was leading them. God had delivered Jesus just as he had delivered Moses from the prison house of death. He was now lifted up and destined to rule the world. Verse 11, a famine and great trouble came over all the land of Egypt and Canaan, and our fathers found no sustenance. But when Jacob heard that there was grain in Egypt, he sent out our fathers first. And so God was working even then, all things together for the good. And as Joseph later told his brothers, he said, "You sold me, but God sent me." Remember when he said, "What you intended for evil, God intended for good." And then he said, "And for the salvation of many." You can go back and read that in Genesis 45 through 50. And God was able to take their rejection of Joseph and make it in the end, an instrument of worldwide salvation. And that, of course, is what Jesus did at Calvary. The cross represents the greatest tragedy in man's dealings with God, the ultimate expression of sin, and yet at the same time, it represents the greatest triumph in God's dealings with man, because God took our sins in Christ, the Bible says, Colossians 2:14, nailed them to the cross. And what man meant for evil, God meant for good. I love it. And in the meantime, God sent in motion a chain of circumstances that brought Joseph's family, just like the dream had foretold, right to his feet. The rejection of Joseph meant that they were going to have to suffer. They were going to go through a season of sorrows as his chosen people. And the famine did come, and the circumstances of life became very difficult for the children of Israel. But do you know what happened through it all? Same thing that happens in your life and my life when we go through difficulty, if we respond the right way. It brings us to the feet of Jesus. It brings us to the feet of our Savior, where we stop fighting God and we stop exalting ourselves in pride, and we just humble ourselves and we bow at the feet of Jesus. But because of their unbelief, they didn't realize they were being driven to Joseph. It's only in the light of the New Testament. This is what I love about the Bible. Scripture interprets Scripture. There are many Old Testament pictures that illustrate New Testament truths or principles. And so we see the New Testament shining on the Old Testament. It helps us appreciate really the wit and the wisdom of Stephen's speech, because what had happened in Joseph's day is going to be repeated, except on a much greater scale, to eventually drive the Jews to Jesus. Verse 13, and the second time Joseph was made known to his brothers, and Joseph's family became known to Pharaoh. Then Pharaoh sent and called his father Jacob and all his relatives to him, 75 people. And so again, Stephen doesn't dwell on the details that they knew by heart, but this Old Testament parallel is very precise. This is also an interesting parallel. Joseph, now at the right hand of Pharaoh, and you remember in the story, he took to himself a Gentile bride. Is this ringing a bell? This is exactly what the Lord is doing. We're called the bride of Christ. and we are going to share in his exaltation. And that's really what God began to do through Joseph, even gave him sons, made him fruitful. And remember the exchange between him and his brother. It seems, when you're reading the story, it seems like he's being really harsh on them. But why did he need to be so harsh? Because their blindness, their stubbornness, their hardness of heart, and they failed to recognize him. But all of it was still motivated by mercy and love. And they were going to come to the place where they would finally say, and you can read it in Genesis 42, 21, they said, "We are truly guilty concerning our brother." Do you remember how long they labored under guilt? And they started to realize, man, all this bad stuff's going down. Maybe God's judging us. I mean, they just had a guilty conscience. And some of you might be going through life and you're just kind of laboring under a guilty conscience thinking, "Oh man, I am in trouble and God hates me." No, he doesn't hate you. But you know what? It's true. He may be bearing down on you in some way through your circumstances, not to punish you, but to discipline. And discipline is teaching. When we discipline our kids, it's always, it should be, in the context of love. It's painful but necessary because we're teaching them something that's going to be good for them in life. And that's the way God deals with his people. And then in this incredibly powerful and emotional scene, Joseph makes himself known to his brothers. In chapter 45 and verse 3, he simply says, "I'm Joseph. I am Joseph." And he gathers his chosen family to himself. And you follow the story, and it's so fun because he includes them in his administration. He gives them all jobs. He gives them all land. He puts them in charge of some stuff, and he includes them in his government. It's all just a reminder pointing to someday the Jews will bow before their Messiah. They will see him and look upon him whom they have pierced, and they will see that he is Lord, and he's going to make them a part of his millennial reign. Amen? God, don't we? That's why we don't ever give up on Israel. We don't ever give up on the Jewish people. God loves them. He has a very important plan for them. Verse 15, so Jacob went down to Egypt and he died, he and our fathers. And they were carried back to Shechem and laid in the tomb that Abraham bought for a sum of money from the sons of Hamor, the father of Shechem. So Joseph and Jacob never lost sight of the promise of God. They always kept before them the land of promise. That was going to be the promise that would be fulfilled in Canaan. And that is why both of them insisted on being buried in Canaan. The Sanhedrin knew this. Stephen knew they knew this. And it was all very relevant because, again, this is all being played out in the day and age in which Stephen lived. In just a few short decades, Israel is going to be driven out of, they're going to be driven out of the city, out of Jerusalem. And they're going to be driven out of their promised land, and they're going to start yet again another long period of wandering throughout the world, a period that would last, well, how long has it been? 2,000 years. And we're coming to the end of that, we believe, but 2,000 years. The Sanhedrin didn't believe it. Stephen did. Why did Stephen believe this? Why was he able to know this? Well, because he was resting his faith on the prophecies, his own scriptures, and he was resting his faith on the teaching of Jesus. Do you remember after the resurrection, Jesus got with the boys and he talked to them and he gave them a little history lesson. Remember it said, and starting there, he went through and he told them, he went through the prophecies and he explained the scriptures to them because they weren't understanding it. Well, the apostles all of a sudden understood, and that's the message they began to proclaim. And so many Jews came to faith in Christ because of the power of God's word to produce conversion in the soul, a change of mind, a change of heart, a change of life. And that's what had happened. They needed to be reminded of the promises, not lose sight of the promises. And so he uses these powerful and prophetic insights, and he's showing how Israel rejected Joseph. And he was just the first of many saviors sent to them by God. Now, next, he approaches this other character in Hebrew culture, and it was Moses. a guy who is really rivaled only by Abraham himself. And the next point I want you to see is Israel's rejection of Moses. That's verses 17 through 29. When the time of the promise drew near, which God had sworn to Abraham. Reminding us that God's eye is always on the clock, okay? God has a timing to the things that he does, and it's always according to these set times. He never forgets a date. He never misses an appointment. They are predetermined in heaven, and God is going to act at just the right time. And we see this as something that right from the beginning of the story in the book of Genesis, even in creation itself, God dwells outside of time and eternity. Did you know that? That time is actually a created thing. And when he created the sun and the moon and the stars, what did he say that they were for? He said they're for times and for seasons. And they help us keep track of time. Why is that important? Because God is working according to a sovereign timetable. And all through the Bible we see this. The book of Daniel constantly speaks of this theme of time. He speaks out into the future about these 70 weeks and how Messiah would be cut off after 69 of those weeks. In the book of Revelation, there's a reference to a period described as a time and times and half a time. Is this a way of saying 3.5 years? It's talking about the last half of the Great Tribulation. More specifically, it's referred to as 1260 days. That's the period related to that second half of the 70th week of Daniel. When the beast sets up his image in the temple, the Jews are going to be able to begin their countdown to the full return of Christ based on this timetable. Jesus, after his resurrection, we're told, remained for 40 days at his ascension. And it was 50 days between Passover and Pentecost. And all of these references to time are not incidental. They're very intentional by God. So the years of the Egyptian exile ran their course. The time drew near for the prophecy to be fulfilled, and God begins to make his move. And we would not believe this were it not for the fact that God told us through Abraham. It says, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt, verse 17, till another king arose who did not know Joseph. So there was a change of dynasties in Egypt. A new regime came to power. The throne was occupied by a new pharaoh. And they began to multiply greatly. Now, this wouldn't have been a big deal if there was just, you know, if it was kind of a small number. But the Hebrew people were a very prolific bunch, and they had swelled into the millions. Some think maybe as many as 2 million people. And this started to become a concern. They were alarmed because what happens if they align with the enemies of the Pharaoh? Started to realize these people have their own sort of, just their own culture, their own religion, their own goals, their own economy, their own history and identity. And so they had to sort of stamp that down. So verse 19 says that this man, the Pharaoh, dealt treacherously with our people and oppressed our forefathers, making them expose their babies so they might not live. And so Pharaoh's solution was along the same lines as another great tyrant in history. We all know the name Hitler. His answer to the Jewish problem was genocide, just the systematic murder of a race. And that was the way Pharaoh looked at the Jews as well. Every male Hebrew born from the date of his decree was to be cast into the Nile River. Now, I think you would agree with me. I can't imagine a more horrific thing, a more sort of heartless reign of a leader than to make a decree like that. I can't imagine being a young mother with a new baby and a soldier knocking on the door and coming and tearing that baby out of my hands and just throwing them in the Nile River. But that was what Satan was up to. See, even if we're not paying attention to God's time clock, Satan is. And he knows that God's going to fulfill his promise through his people. That's why all through the story, there's these reminders that Satan is always trying to kill and stop the line of the Messiah. And so Stephen sort of sets the stage for another act in Israel's history of rejecting their saviors. That's the theme. You guys always reject your saviors. At this time, verse 20, Moses was born and was well-pleasing to God, and he was brought up in his father's house for 3 months. So this was a familiar story to them, didn't really need any commentary, but you remember Moses' mother, Jochebed? She came up with this ingenious plan to save her little boy. And she got to thinking, you know, how does God save people from judgment? And the text doesn't say this, but I can imagine it's very likely she would have thought of Noah and the ark. Because what she did is fashion a sort of a little miniature ark for her baby in this basket and put him in the waters of judgment, as it were, the Nile River. And you know the story. It ends up being ingenious because the Pharaoh's daughter took him in and brought him up. And Stephen says that Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians. And this is sort of a separate part of the story I don't have time to go into, but it's thought that historically the woman who this would have been was someone by the name of Hatshepsut, and she was the daughter of a pharaoh, but she also grew up and married a pharaoh. And then she became a pharaoh for 21 years. And it's believed that she would have sort of groomed Moses to take her place and be the pharaoh and take the throne. Why is this significant? Because again, Moses also is a type of Christ. A reminder that Jesus is coming. And like our Savior, he gave up a throne to step down to Israel's need. And the Bible says that that's what the Lord Jesus did. He came down from heaven from his throne in order to meet us in our need. But Stephen says that Moses was mighty in words and deeds. He was mighty in words. God called him to become Israel's redeemer. And remember what he said when in the book of Exodus chapter 4, Moses said, but I'm not very eloquent. Well, I don't know if he said it quite like that. Some think that maybe what is meant by the way he described his inability to speak and his resistance to God was maybe he had some kind of, you know, deficiency in his speech. And I'm not so sure about that. I kind of find that hard to believe. It may just be that, you know, he'd been living on the backside of the desert for 40 years. Maybe he just wasn't up on his Egyptian, you know? Maybe we just don't know. There's different conjecture about things. Some think that mighty in words may have nothing to do with his eloquence of speaking. It may have to do with his writing ability. We know he wrote the first 5 books of the Bible, the 5 books of Moses, the Torah, and in those, he demonstrates great eloquence. Read the book of Deuteronomy and some of the monologues that are in there. It's amazing how eloquent he was. He was also a man who was mighty indeed. Josephus, a Jewish historian, says that while a member of Pharaoh's court, Moses led a campaign against the Ethiopians. That's in his writings called the Antiquities. And so we don't know for sure, but we do know that Moses was prepared by God to do what God called him to do, to be a savior to his people. Now, when he was 40 years old, verse 23, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel, and seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended and avenged him who was oppressed and struck down the Egyptian, for he supposed that his brethren would have understood that God would deliver them by his hand, but they did not understand. And so we're going to stop here, and I'm going to have to leave you with a cliffhanger, okay? We're going to pick it up next week, but this is the point. God had been faithful to send his saviors in the past to his people, but they did not understand. And scripture says it's not that they could not, it's that they would not. God had revealed himself. And I take this to mean, even in our own lives, we must consider, are we resisting the Lord in any area of life? Some of you may not yet have even come into a saving faith in Christ. Maybe you are one who's sort of depended on religion and tradition. Well, I was baptized when I was a baby, or I was confirmed and christened, or I went to this church my whole life growing up, or I go to this church faithfully every week, or almost every week, Pastor. And there's things that you think that this is going to be sort of what gets you into God's good graces. And the Bible says that It's not like that. It's not by works that we could merit the salvation of God. It's by faith alone and God's grace alone. That's what the story teaches us. Abraham walked by faith. He didn't depend on Moses, the law, traditions, the temple. This was all prior to Abraham lived by faith, prior to all of that stuff. And even once Moses came, and God did work through Moses to establish those things, it was all intended simply to point to a coming deliverer. And Stephen is speaking to people who are very religious. They claim to love God, they claim to know the scriptures, but their hearts are far from God. And so even as Christians today, our hearts can be far from God because we can be walking in sinful habits where we're just resisting the work of the Lord. We're resisting. God sends us messengers. God even sometimes bears down on us in circumstances that are difficult to get our attention. And we can continue to be stubborn and stiff-necked and miss what the Savior has for us. And so I take this as a really powerful reminder that God is incredibly patient and gracious. And let's not take advantage of that. These people came to know God through the trials and the hardships of life as God was with them. He heard their cries. He loved them. He continually revealed himself to them. He did not forsake them. And he hasn't forsaken us. Would you stand together with me? Father, thank you for the reminder that you are faithful. Forgive us, Lord, for our unfaithfulness. I pray, Father, that as a result of just spending time in your word today, that you would bring conviction to bear on our hearts, Lord, not in any way to hurt us, but to help us. I pray, Father, that we would not be stubborn, that we would take a lesson from the example of Israel over the years, and we would just see our Joseph, our Savior. We would see our Jesus. And I pray, Lord, that we would trust you. And Lord, whatever persecution we go through, whatever injustice, whatever attacks of the enemy, may we just remember that you are always with us and you're working out your purpose and your deliverance in our life in just the right time and just the right way. And you will use whoever and whatever means it takes to get us home and to make us like you. So thank you for that. Help us to trust you for that. In Jesus' name, God's people said, amen. Amen. You can be dismissed.